Now that's a tough act to follow. I think I actually forgot what I was going to say back there watching that video. Hello, it's a pleasure to be with you all here at RSA 2017. I'm Matt Moynahan, CEO of Forcepoint. I'm going to begin today by dating myself a little bit. This is my 19th year in the cybersecurity industry. And over the span of that time, but particularly the last few years, I've been seeing increasing concerns from our mutual customers. And I imagine, because the voices have been loud at times, that you might be hearing the same thing. I'm hearing that security has never been more important to them. I'm hearing that the risks they're facing have never been more dire, but that we, as an industry, are meeting their needs less and less. I'm hearing that in the current course, our industry runs a risk of becoming irrelevant. In short, I'm hearing that we have to change. Today, I'd like to share with you my perspective on how we can begin that change process. And it's pretty simple. It's by focusing our time and effort on the one true constant that has been in existence since the security industry began, and that is people. So let's start by taking a look at people and the risk they pose for today's security paradigm. In fact, let's start with myself. Meet Matt, the worst nightmare for enterprise security. He looks like me, but he looks like you, and you, and you. In my particular case, it's particularly dangerous. I have authority at my company. I write and influence policy. I have access to my systems. I know how we defend those systems. I know where those defenses are deployed. I've got access to Raytheon, who has access to the US government. But I am trusted. And I, like every human being in this room, though, change. I can go from good employee one day to a malicious insider the next. I could go from a good employee one day to a compromised good employee the next. Unintentionally or intentionally owned by a malicious outsider or nation state. And how much of an enemy I actually am, or should I say we are, depends. There are any number of external factors and stressors that could impact my intent behind the behavior. Did my wife lose her job and make me feel like I have a little bit more pressure to provide for the family with one income? Is my job on that oil rig off the Gulf Coast at risk because the price of oil has fallen 15% 3 years straight? Was I approached by an outsider with a get-rich-quick scheme that seemed far too good to be true, but too good to turn down? Have I been blackmailed? Or did I simply not get enough sleep the night before when I clicked on that page that looked a lot like Google, that gave access to my campaign's email servers to a nation state up to no good? Does it really matter how they got in, or just the fact that they got in? All the while, we seem to have this funny obsession with malware. Now, don't get me wrong, malware has been good to me over the years as far as making a living. But even the term feels a little 1980s, doesn't it? But I guess that's sort of my point. Our greatest challenge today isn't so much malware, or if I could be bold and say, even the hackers behind that malware. It's determining who that malware became once it got in. What name did they take? Maybe it was Matt. Maybe it was Dave. Maybe it was Megan. You see, malware has just continued the great tradition in security. It's all about impersonation. Whether it's catch me if you can and the check forgery, or phone calls, or fake wire transfer, whatever it may be, the best malware simply behaves like a human. And humans are vulnerable. Humans are the ultimate vulnerability, because they're not neat, predictable streams of ones and zeros. And this complexity brought about the mashing together between human beings and extremely rapid technological change is sitting at the heart of the next big issue our industry has to address. And it's not like our customers haven't been trying to help us. They've trusted us and given us great sums of money to protect them and have their backs in the darkest of hours. Indeed, they've invested billions over the course of the past 7 to 10 years and are even going to spend at an increased rate. It's a little bit crazy how little of progress we feel like we've made. In one recent study Forcepoint has commissioned, less than a third of you feel like you're getting your money's worth for the total cybersecurity spend. When was the last time anyone spent $10, $20, $30, $40, $50 million and didn't feel good about that purchase? How would you feel? I'd be a little frustrated. Another data point was that less than half of the industry feels that more technology is going to solve the problem. So what do we do when $1 trillion leads to 90 to 95% of all enterprises being owned, when you look at any research study? Unfortunately, there really is no easy fix, no silver bullet. Each year at this conference, everyone gets excited and feels the buzz around some new technology that is designed to combat the latest threat. Today, we're all buzzing about AI and machine learning and big data as potential holy grails to the cybersecurity problem. I certainly hope that is the case. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm a big fan of big data. The use cases are transformative. Understanding the human genome and getting through petabytes of information, clinical trials, maybe helping us solve cancer, unbelievable. Presenting dynamic offers in consumer environments within microseconds and tying preference to options as far as offers, I find value every day. But finding someone in real time that's hiding in the seams of your IT infrastructure that looks like the person to your left or your right whom you trust, all the while knowing that you're looking for them, I'm not so sure about that. I hope I'm wrong. The point is that we still haven't made progress against the root cause, because the IT technology landscape is moving far faster than our thinking. How many times have we heard the good guys are ahead of the bad guys, or the bad guys ahead of the good guys, cops and robbers, they're one step behind, can't catch them? You know, I actually don't believe that to be true. I wish we were just one step behind them. I would posit that's not the case. The root cause is that we're one step behind all the consumer innovation and technology that's being built in Silicon Valley. All of that innovation that's coming into the enterprise and changing the way we work and play. And unfortunately, this great thing has caused the cat to get out of the bag. And now that it's out, I don't think we're ever going to get it back in. Another study we commissioned among hundreds of enterprises, again, small sample set, but certainly enough to get a picture here, was that 25% of the enterprise we sampled have critical data or IP on removable media. 50% have critical data or IP on mobile devices, BYOD devices. 50% have it in private clouds, which I'm not that surprised about, but 20% have critical data and IP in public clouds. Making things worse, you've got the intermingling between consumer and business apps on the same devices. 50% of all enterprises viewed this as a disaster. There is literally so much technological change going on. It's beyond our control to restore the comfortable old world of the walled garden. We've been trying, but we've come nowhere close. So where do we go from here? I'm a history major by trade, and sometimes I feel comfort in going to the past to look for reference points on what we can do to improve the future. In this particular case, I think it's worth going back and looking at a call to action from Thomas Kuhn back in the tumultuous 1960s. Kuhn was a leading thinker in the philosophy of science and studied the process of scientific breakthroughs. is perhaps more relevant today for our industry than it could have ever been or he could have ever seen. It's about our paradigm of over-reliance on technology and walls. In my opinion, it's just one person's opinion, I think we might suffer from a profound case of what Kuhn called confirmation bias. It was an interesting concept back in the 60s by all the cognitive scientists. And essentially, the concept is pretty simple. The experts of the day can't see beyond their own innovation to have breakthrough innovations to solve the problems of tomorrow. In essence, I wonder whether we've lost our perspective to see the forest from the trees. This old adage we've all heard before, if all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. Think about it. What are the implications of that? If we buy into the notion of Kuhn in subverting the dominant paradigm, where should we look for inspiration? Let's look to the place where we've taken most of our language that suited us so well over the years, the military. The concept of moats and walls and kills, most recently the kill chain, which I think last year was one of the bigger terms, just happened to be invented by Lockheed Martin. Here's what I've learned over the past 9 months through our corporate relationship with Raytheon. A front row seat into watching how the military tries to protect its critical assets, including people. When you talk to the folks who are trying to protect nation states, they think so differently than Silicon Valley. The term cyber is just one attack vector among the entire portfolio of attack vectors that they're trying to protect us from. Many of us have lived in a subset of that neighborhood, not even the entire vector, for our careers. I come from a small fishing village outside of Boston, Gloucester, Massachusetts, about 40 miles north of Boston. We had this term as a kid saying, getting over the bridge. It's literally an island, and most people never left. They lost perspective until they got to Boston. I won't even go into that because I'm sure whole different kettle of fish talking about Boston. But when you need perspective to be able to see, to be self-aware, for improvement. So ironically, in borrowing walls and moats terms, we may have taken the wrong idea from the right place. Because when the military actually thinks about protecting itself, protecting countries, they tend to think in terms of people, behaviors, and motivations. In fact, if there's one thing the military will teach you, is that the more walls and moats you put up, the closer the adversary will come to the target to achieve its ends. I think the lesson from this is that if someone is on your network, you should assume they're in your network. The outside is now in. And how do you stop that threat when there's three or four mats on the network? Which one is the real mat? There is no quick fix, but I do think it's fair to say that we have to really consider whether we have a big data problem or whether we have a little data problem. It's time for us to ignore the myriad of noise from the network and the endpoints that mean nothing if they're not tied to something. The critical pools of ones and zeros that come from human interaction with information technology, with critical data and intellectual property, is the next playground for this industry. It's all about determining intent of the people who are doing their jobs and whether they're doing it for good or whether they're doing it for bad. I would actually encourage the entire security industry to help enterprises understand their workforces like consumer companies understand their consumer bases. Because people are the one and only constant. And the human interactions between critical data and information systems can easily get bypass a cybersecurity design of the most sophisticated nature. There are implications to this. And in order to make this quantum leap forward, there are some fundamental truths that we have to acknowledge and stare right in the eyes if we want to collectively stop the bad and free the good. First is a cyber continuum of intent. It is far broader and more difficult to defend than at any time in this country's history, the world's history. We've spent most of our time on the far right of that continuum, the devious hooded hacker coming from the outside, trying to do nefarious types of things. And yes, that's been there. But there's more we can learn from those on the left. The woman on the far left is a great employee who happens to be sad. Unfortunately, the old adage, the sad harm themselves, the mad harm others. We see it more and more on the news, whether it's San Bernardino or Orlando. This is a real, real issue. And yes, physical workplace violence does fall under the chief security officer and HR. We have to pay attention to this entire continuum, including the person right in the middle, who you don't know and who may be owned, or that happy-looking person there who might accidentally press a button, who's a very good employee, and send credit card or intellectual property out of the four walls of your business. All of these people and all of these emotions and behaviors are in your workforce today at this very moment, for good or bad. And all of them are important to understand. The second is how CISOs actually need to think about their workforces. I oftentimes start out a conversation with a CIO or a CISO and say, who at this very minute, inside of these four walls, in your company, knows more about your workforce? Google, Facebook, the NSA, or you? What do you think the answer is? 99 out of 100 say Facebook. Some say Google, and then the NSA. Remember, wasn't the NSA the bad guy long ago? So what does this mean? It means that consumers, which happen to be employees, are willingly allowing consumer companies to understand their behaviors and intentions while they're at work. It happens to be an exchange of value in return for free emails and apps and what have you. It also means that CISOs aren't the bad guys for trying to figure out how to responsibly understand the behaviors and intentions of their workforce as it interacts with data and content that they own that could also bring the company down. So what if the CISO stole a playbook out of the consumer companies? But for CISOs, it's different than some of the large consumer companies. It's all about finding the bad apple in the big bushel to make sure that the company stays solvent. It's not about understanding everybody. We've got to be careful. I would encourage that everyone in this room to think of the relationship and reset it with your security officers. And think of it as a partnership working together to stop the bad behavior that hurts companies and frees the good for the benefit of everyone inside of your company. Third, crowdsourcing. What if employees actually willingly participated in making the job of a CISO easier for the benefit of all their comrades inside of the workforce? In my opinion, the third hard truth is that best security going forward will increasingly be crowdsourced. That crowd is your employees. It's your customers. It's your partners. It's any human being that touches your network. Anyone on your network who you are paying, who you are creating value for, and who you're creating value with needs to be accounted for. And it's only through the power of understanding end users and their intentions and cyber behaviors at scale can we make the workplace safer. Crowdsourcing helped catch the Boston bombers. Law enforcement would have taken far longer to catch the suspects if it wasn't for thousands of people, Bostonians and visitors, who uploaded thousands of videos and hundreds of thousands of photos within hours with time, date, location information to catch the bombers. I wonder what crowdsourcing would do for an enterprise in the life of a CISO if we help them out. Finally, and as painful as it may be for those in the room today, including myself, and with apologies to Arthur C. Clarke, technology is no longer magic. And technology is as likely to be part of the cybersecurity problem as it is a solution if the security industry, who's being tasked to protect enterprises and nation states, keep looking through the problem itself through the lens of technology. The one constant in the sea of change that we've been chasing and that has been challenging us is people. And as we've seen in the Boston bomber case, if people come together, they can work magic. I would encourage every single one of us in the room today to subvert the dominant paradigm. Enterprises, employees, and cybersecurity practitioners to enable people to be part of the solution. Let them opt in, just like they do in the consumer world. And if we can accomplish this, we will easily demonstrate our continued relevance to our customers for decades to come. Thank you.